Breach, what's the biggest thing you learned from the owners' meetings?
Brenton, the biggest thing I learned is that the owners are suddenly open to these huge changes. I mean, this group is normally so conservative. They hate making big rule changes that really kind of change the philosophy of how you play the game or a certain aspect of the game, as we saw with this kickoff rule. I mean, this is unprecedented. I was trying to think of the biggest rule changes we've seen probably in our lifetimes. I would say the two-point conversion would be one. Adding instant replay, bringing that back, which was in the late 90s, would be one. And maybe moving the extra point back. But again, the extra point rule, they made that a preseason rule for 2 years in 2014. And then they said, let's do it again in preseason 2015. And then we'll do it the trial during the regular season 2015. So they were like, we're not even going to move the extra point back until we have all this evidence that this makes sense. And with this kickoff rule, they just said, you know what? Screw it. We're just going to vote this thing through. We don't care what happens. We have no idea how this is going to play out. And we saw the Packers, 49ers, Raiders vote for it. And the Packers and 49ers both said that's why they voted against it, is because, hey, we'd like to see this maybe as a preseason trial first before we go jumping into the deep end. But nope, the owners, if the NFL wants a big change, Goodell proved he can push it through and convince the owners to do it with this vote this week.
Well, I'll kind of commend them for it too. I for mine, and we'll get to it in a second, I'm kind of being a little bit more pessimistic, but for the sake of them changing this kickoff rule, I like that they're being so aggressive and I would say proactive to a degree. I mean, we're recording this on Thursday. It's MLB's opening day. Baseball was so slow to make certain changes, and it really drastically hurt the viewership and the overall enjoyment of baseball. And you've seen them kind of over recent years make the bases bigger, put in a pitch clock. They've tried to change.
The pitch clock is a game changer.
It's awesome, but it's also like 5 years too late.
Yes.
They should have done it so much earlier. And so we were talking about this on the most previous podcast, that the kickoff just became such a ceremonial nothing play where you're going to the bathroom, you're still getting your beer, you're grabbing your food, you're doing whatever, but paying attention to football. Now you actually need to go sit down because something could happen, or at least that's what they're hoping. It'll be a more meaningful play in a game. And so to me, I commend them for doing this and being proactive and being as aggressive as they are.
Yeah, I mean, I think you guys can both be right in this instance, where it is good by the NFL owners to be proactive, to make, like, the kickoff was worthless, you know, and these kickers have such strong legs, they're just booming out of the back of the end zone, or, you know, guys are waving, it's falling down. And I understand, like, you know, they also, you know, because they moved it up, they wanted to make it, like, safer. I mean, the kick returns are the most dangerous play in football, and that's why they changed them. It's where the most concussions were happening. It's where the biggest impacts were happening. And now you're just not going to have any impact in terms of the blockers. And I think or minimal impact. And I think that's pretty – I think that's a – you know, it changes how these guys who are special teamers, like, you know, Matthew Slater just retired, right? I mean, like, you know, lifetime special teams guy, like a borderline Hall of Fame special teams guy. And it's going to change how these special teams guys – maybe fit onto rosters, but it's also going to mean like less injuries for guys who are starters, who are, you know, playing special teams, because that's what you have to have with the NFL. I think to Breach's point, the fact that these owners are willing to do this so, or to your, maybe to both your points, the fact that they did this so aggressively and so like just screw it, who knows what's going to happen, let's borrow this thing from the XFL. The first month of the season is going to be insane. Like, this, I mean, these guys don't, there's like, nobody knows what the edge is here in terms of the special teams. Like, even the coaches can't know until you actually see it enacted. There's going to be guys who have special returns built in. There's going to be guys who aren't, you know, like they're going to be idiot coaches who don't pay attention to the special teams as much as they should. I mean, there's going to be chaos for the first month. So well, I'm excited for that.
And part of that, though, is that obviously we're going to see this in the preseason, but I think that special team coaches are not going to want to give anything away. So
right. We're
just going to see the standard kick returns, which still it will spice it up because we're seeing the new kickoff in the preseason. But yeah, I don't think we're actually going to know how this plays out until we get to the regular season. Of course, the downside here is you can no longer use the kickoff as a bathroom break. Which I did at Super Bowl 56 when the Bengals played the Rams, because I'm only bringing this up because this is your mindset. We had to do the post-game podcast. I was at the game with my family, and at the 2-minute warning, I knew I had to go to the bathroom and I wasn't going to be able to make it till the end of the podcast. We're talking, you know, between the end of the game and the podcast, it was probably 2 hours before I was going to get a shot. But as soon as the Rams scored a touchdown, I think there was like a minute 25 left. I was like, I don't need to see the kickoff because they're just going to kick it in the end zone. It's going to be a touchback. But I did risk that if it's not a touchback, you know, the Bengals might return it for a touchdown. I missed the game winning score and I would regret that for the rest of my life. But nope, my theory worked. Matt Gay kicked in the end zone for a touchback. I didn't miss anything, made it back. So you can't do that anymore because we're going to get returns now.
Right. Yeah. And I think it's also interesting from the perspective of how this is going to, what this means for kickers specifically, like guys who are able to really, you know, like, I mean, for lack of a better like analogy, it's sort of like how's your wedge game? You know, like, can you stuff wedges from 100 yards out into that landing zone and really force returners to make a decision? Because it's really creative and exciting, and I'm kind of excited for it.
Yeah, Sully, and to that point, let me say one thing quick, Prince. Yeah. I was actually texting with my dad about the rule, and
humble brag.
I think this is former NFL kicker. You got to talk about it. So one of the things though is that look, NFL kickers are better than XFL kickers. So I think that's something that I don't know if the owners really thought that part of it through. So they're going to have better ball placement, as Brinson said, better wedge game. This is like PGA guys versus college golfers, what we're talking here. And so, you know, your plan, I think, as a special teams coach is to make sure the ball hits the ground because that gives the coverage team an extra second or two, and maybe the returner has trouble fielding it. So I think the ultimate plan is going to be for the ball to somehow hit the ground, but where that happens is going to be up to each special teams coach.
So your big takeaway involves Jesus.
Yes, it does. It's Jesus's birthday. And sorry, Jesus, your birthday does not matter anymore. And sorry, NBA, your marquee day on the calendar does not matter anymore, because Christmas is forever going to be a marquee event on the NFL calendar. They said way back when, or, you know, last year or whatever, that they weren't going to do it. They weren't going to have a Christmas Day game, whether if it was in the middle of the week, only if it was a special circumstance or it landed on a football specific day. Well, Christmas is on a Wednesday this year. And guess what the NFL is doing? They're playing a game on a Wednesday. They're playing two games, actually, Brinson. You're right. They're playing two games. So not only are you getting one, you're getting a doubleheader. It just goes to show you that they found something here. They feel like this is a window for them to really get a lot of viewership, and rightfully so, it's going to be. But to me, you know, it's just going forward, we're working on Christmas, fellas. You know, I look at it selfishly. I'm like, hey, all right, we're working on Christmas. But yes, going forward, NFL Christmas, it's forever going to be a thing.
You know, I guess I can say this, but it used to be, this is before Breach got here. I would just say that the having a disparate number of religious beliefs on your NFL staff, your NFL writing staff, can be a bonus for you.
True.
Depending on the holiday that you're trying to discuss.
I guess that's true.
Yeah.
Brinson, all you're saying is not everyone celebrates Christmas, and some people don't mind working on Christmas.
That's what I'm saying, Breach. My mom is a retired minister. She is disgusted and appalled at the idea of football. I said, football. She's like, football is family. It's a load of crap. I'm like, well, I'm not wrong. And she's like, the idea of like football and Christmas just does not sit well with her at all. And I told my family last year, I was like, look, get used to it because these ratings are so good. They love the idea of like football being associated with holidays. And this is shoving it right down Jesus's throat. I mean, I get that Jesus apparently bought a bunch of Super Bowl ads, three of them, I believe. Like, you know, it's like, wait, what's up with this budget, Jesus?
I guess we should have known, right?
Yeah, I mean, really, you pay. Yeah, I guess he's like, hey, I'm going to buy these three ads. You got to put these two games on my birthday. look, it's. I think what's really disturbing about it is that the argument that Roger Goodell made for it was, well, it's just like playing on a Thursday. It's just like playing on a Sunday and then playing on a Thursday. Carpenters, but this economy. And they're like, well, it's just like playing on a Saturday, because the two teams who play on Wednesday will play on a Saturday before that, right? They're going to play on the Saturday before Christmas. That's what they said. That's going to be the schedule. But it's like, just like, everybody agrees Thursday night football is forced. Like, what do you mean? It's just like a Thursday night football game. It's like, that doesn't make it better. You're forcing four teams to play on Christmas Day. And look, I mean, I get, you know, I don't know, man. I I like the idea of Christmas and no football. I like the idea of watching football on Christmas. I don't like the idea of working on Christmas. It's just not a very appealing, especially when you have a young kid. And so selfishly, like, that part bothers me. But I also just, I don't know, man. I always kind of like the idea that you got some football on Christmas every couple of years, but for the most part, like, it was perfectly fine for the NFL to take Christmas off. And so that part kind of bugs me.
They are never taking Christmas off again. It's been five straight years, and if they're playing on Wednesday, they're going to play on any day that Christmas falls on. I will say, though, from the safety standpoint, and Brinson, you just mentioned the part how Goodell compared to play a Sunday-Thursday game. So it's definitely similar as far as the break goes. So however you feel about Thursday night football, you know, it's one thing, but it is the same break. But honestly, if I'm a team, I don't mind playing the Christmas game. Because right. Now you get an 11-day break before week 18. If you clinch that wild card spot and you rest your starters in week 18, you literally get 18 days for your team to rest at the end of the season. So that's a break.
Is that too much, though?
Well, I mean, then you play maybe you're still playing for seed in week 18, but I'm saying the fact that if you're in a wild card battle and you even have that option, that's an option that usually only goes to winning the division. So I don't think it's the worst thing in the world for a team to be stuck playing this game, which would be in week 17. It'll be the first two games of week 17, in case anyone's wondering how that would work.
Yeah. They'll have a game on Thursday too.
Right. So I have it in front of me. This is Field Yates tweeted it out when it was all coming out. December 25th NFL game, December 26th NFL game, December 28th NFL game, December 29th NFL game, December 30th NFL game, and then the next 2 days college football playoffs. A lot of football.
Hey, look, I love football. Lots of football is always a good thing. I just, you know, it feels a little forced on a Wednesday, but here we are. That's how it's going to work. I'm trying to decide. We need to get to a break. So I was going to say my big takeaway is just that we're going to get four quarterbacks in the top 10. And that there are a lot of teams trying to trade down in this draft, and you're going to see a lot of action at 3, 4, and 5 in particular, I think. I don't know how we feel about the Pats, Sully, but I mean, I would expect that they're interested in trading down if they don't love the quarterback at 3, or do you think they'll stick
there? I think it's generally lying season. I think they're taking a quarterback. I think they'll end up being born and sticking at 3.
Jim Harbaugh not making any bones about it. Like, that was my big – Jim Harbaugh is like – like, all right, you know, like I tell you what, these guys, all these GMs, all these personnel guys, they love JJ McCarthy. And I mean, they really love him. It's like, Jim, you're a 5. Everyone knows you're trying to trade down. You're pumping up JJ McCarthy's value. I mean, that being said, maybe JJ McCarthy goes 2. I mean, that was the rumor that was out there. I think that we can have some real chaos after Caleb Williams goes. That's sort of my big takeaway, Breach.
Yeah. I mean, that feels like what Jim Harbaugh does want. I love the fact that he was just being the ultimate salesman out there saying, oh, JJ McCarthy's the best quarterback in the draft. Somebody call us and come up and trade up and get JJ McCarthy. He's trying to make sure that 4 quarterbacks go in the top 4 so that they have the first non-quarterback pick. Jim Harbaugh's brilliant.
Let me just ask you this real quick. Is this giving you any like Will Levis vibes from last year? Where, because the betting odds for Will Levis was like he was going number 2, he got skyrocketed the day of the draft, and then the dude fell to the second round. Is JJ McCarthy? I mean, obviously we think he's a better prospect than Will Levis, but is this kind of pumping of the tires similar in that regard of teams just kind of lying and boosting value?
No, but only because I think the way that things have lined up with the draft and with the quarterback carousel, like the Panthers sort of blew it up by trading up for Bryce, because like if the Panthers had stayed, I think that the quarterback carousel is such that like all 4 of these guys have landing spots pretty easily, right? Because the Cousins thing. So now you have Oakland, you have Minnesota, you have New England, Washington. And it's like, the Bears are making no bones about it. The Commanders are clear what they're going to do. You think the Patriots are clear? The Chargers are the Chargers and the Cardinals are in prime position to trade out in a deep draft. So I think a little bit different. But yeah, I mean, I know what you're saying. Like, you know, late March when somebody's odds are JJ McCarthy's like 2-1 to go 6th overall. Like, pump you that you could probably pump the brakes on.
But to answer Sully's question, I don't think McCarthy goes top 3.
Yeah, right. I think he goes top 5.
I can see that, yeah.